And for today's Focus at 4, we're happy to have with us A&M Professor of Philosophy, Dr. Clara Katz. Dr. Katz says if we want to help stop bullying and other problems in school, like respect for adults, it's time to introduce kids as early as elementary school to philosophy. So Dr. Katz, you're basically saying little Johnny and little Susie, when we send them off to elementary school, in addition to reading, writing, and arithmetic, we also need to be teaching them philosophy.
That's right.
Is that age appropriate?
Yes, it is. And we've established that through many of the studies that have been done recently. So if I take you back to when Philosophy for Children was first starting, maybe about 40 years ago in the 70s, Matt Lippman introduced this program. He was a professor of philosophy at Columbia University. And interestingly, even with their big teachers, teachers college there, they were not as interested in the program. And Montclair, which was also a teachers college, recruited him and he started an institute. And he developed a series of essentially philosophy books that were aimed at kids. They were modeled on Charlie Brown, where the kids are the ones modeling the behavior, the adults are kind of in the background, and Plato's dialogues. And the idea of the dialogue is to demonstrate to the people reading how one would actually engage in a philosophical discussion. And he started with books that were aimed primarily at middle school kids, and eventually develop books that were for first graders, kindergarten first graders. And so yes, we are doing philosophy with kids as young as 5 and 6.
So your writing here says that this could actually help as they go through middle school and as they go through high school with issues like bullying and respect and other issues that we see maybe with students nowadays. So how do you envision this unfolding, or how do you do it in a classroom? Is this something that they take as a specific subject, or is this something that the teachers integrate into their education? How does this work?
It can be both. So the Philosophy for Children program, designed in the way that it is, for it to work, they need to spend about 50 minutes or so, almost 1 hour, one time a week, for about 26 weeks. That's the study that was just done by, of all people, Frank Fair at Sam Houston State, so right down the street in Huntsville. The study that they did replicated a study that was done in Durham, Scotland, and the idea there was that they had about 56 weeks, and of course, we don't have that kind of time here, especially with a lot of the testing going on. And so they implemented it in a school system in Huntsville ISD, and they found that really with only about 26 weeks, I think one teacher reported about 22 weeks, so between 22 and 26 weeks, 1 hour a week will have this kind of effect to improve math skills, reading skills, of cognitive ability, but there's a halo effect to it. What they've been able to show is that it now has, of course with math skills, it relates to STEM education, which of course is huge right now. But the larger issue is the sort of transcendent issue, or how it transcends all of these. It's the anecdotal evidence that we're getting both from teachers and from the kids. The kids are self-reporting about this, that there's increased civility, there's a unity or a unified feeling that they have in the classroom with their peers. Listening, the way in which philosophy works, we think about philosophy and thinking as being done in a solitary way. But philosophy, if it's done well, I'm a real Aristotelian here, is done better with friends. You do it with others. And so it creates a community of inquiry. You sit in a classroom with others and you're actually engaged in these dialogues about things that could be as abstract as time, but also things that could be as meaningful and deep as bullying or bystander issues. What do I do when I see something happening? What's my responsibility?
And I imagine that teachers have to be your biggest cheerleaders on something like this. Who are the skeptics for this idea?
Interestingly, I have the people who I've worked with, the people who actually engage with the program, love it. So my sense is I've not come across someone yet who just outright says, I don't want anything to do with this. Yeah. It's going to be someone who at the front end says, I don't think kids can do this, and I don't want your proof. Because the proof is now out there, especially now when I said I did this 30 years ago. The studies are coming out just almost daily of people working with this. So the data's there.
You talk about proof. We'll put some of that online at kbtx.com. I want to mention, you have kids in public school.
Yes.
You've been overseas exploring this issue, mm-hmm. bringing it to other countries as well. And you're also having some workshops for teachers here at home. So for our viewers watching, parents going, you know what, yeah, this does make sense. Uh-huh. What happens from here? What do you take it from here?
So what I would have to say is I'm just so grateful to the support I'm getting at A&M, you know, the college, my department, and especially the public partnership and outreach department mm-hmm. through the provost office. We're beginning to organize workshops. I mean, we have I'm in a land grant university. Texas A&M is a land grant. So in addition to being an R1 university, we have a special mission, a special obligation to the state of Texas. And so we're taking that seriously, and philosophers and A&M are going to lead the way.
Interesting stuff. Dr. Katz, thank you so much for joining us. I could talk for the next 2 hours about this stuff, but we'll put a lot more information for our viewers online at kbtx.com along with this interview.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us. Sure. We appreciate this. And of course, this is what we're asking on Facebook this afternoon. Do you think that philosophy should be a